Great. Yeah, let's start. RWMS. I call it practical reactive architecture. Now, you might wonder why another architecture? And but on the other side, I could ask, is there any established Flutter architecture? And I think there isn't, because we have some patterns that we know from other environments like MVP, MVVM, but they don't really fit well for Flutter. And we have state management solutions, we have state management packages, which are nice, but state management is only a small part inside an architecture. An architecture describes how an whole app is designed, is structured, is organized. So yeah, and the best way that fits is as a pattern is MVU, but as I said, it does not tell you how to structure your app. So what were my goals when I started to explore possibilities of architectures with Flutter? One thing, actually, if you think, if you wonder about this X above there, the reason is when I started with this, I called it RxVMS because it was based on streams. The current version doesn't need streams anymore. That's the reason why I called it RWMS. And yeah, the goals were, and this is, I kind of strengthened this enough, how important it is that code is readable and explorable. Because if you enter a new code base, and or even your own after half a year, it's hard to navigate in there, and you don't understand what your code is doing, you have really a problem. And this was one of the things I experienced when I first tried to understand some Redux apps, because if you start at the UI code in a Redux app and you try with go to definition in your IDE to track down what is happening, sometimes you can't go further because everything is abstract, extract interfaces, and there's no connection. So I definitely didn't want this. Also, no configuration by convention, yeah? So nothing that is going... Oh, sorry, I have to kill this. So. Okay. No black magic behind the curtains that is done that I don't see inside the code, yeah? So nothing by convention. Then it should allow you to get a feeling that you really develop a whole feature, so not just any layer in an architecture, so not just on the UI layer, but also below. You should be able to say, okay, no, I'm responsible for this whole slice of the app. And I'm not a fan of boilerplate code, I also didn't want to have any of them or really little of them, and it should be highly reactive to match Flutter's main feature. And what do I mean by this? I mean it should be reactive in a way that an event from the user triggers an action, and automatically UI reacts on it. Yeah, so we don't wait for any result that we get back, but we completely decouple the input event and the output event. So the general structure of an RWMS app looks like this. We have views, managers, and services. So that's the secret behind RWMS, reactive view manager services. And besides this, we have domain objects and aggregators, adapters. And domain objects, I think everyone knows what it means with this, and aggregators adapters just means that sometimes we have to pass data several objects as one object somewhere else. So we need some aggregator or adapter to do this. Now, what are these layers? One, views is quite obvious. it means it's a page or a complex widget. Then managers are everything what I would call business logic. But important, a manager is more than a view object as a view model, because it can be used from several views. A manager groups things on a semantic level. So like we have a user manager who does everything from login, user creation, etc. So typically managers are long-lived objects. And below this, we have services. Services are the adapters to the outside world of the app. So things like REST APIs, databases, or hardware sensors. And they allow us to access all of them in a convenient manner. So they also do all the data conversions that makes it easier to work with deserialization and all this stuff. So the here's an example how this could look like in an app. So we have our different views, and we have here two managers, an invoice manager, for example, in some business app, and a user manager. And now the important thing is data is changed only by the management layer. Yeah? Data is only changed by the management layer. No view directly changes data, and no service directly changes data. Yeah. So if the view wants to update data, it triggers a command inside a manager, and the manager will then either communicate with another manager or go down to one of the services to do its job. Now, the communication is always strictly organized. A view either uses a command, we will see in a moment what a command is, to access a manager, or just calls a function of a manager. In some case, a function is completely enough. The data is sent back by the use of a value listenable, like a value notifier, so that the view in question directly updates when this data changes. The databases, the services, in this case, you can imagine they make it easier. They are the adapters, and the managers communicate with them typically over async functions or streams. And it's allowed that a view can access a manager, but only for reading, because like in this case, a location service, it doesn't really make sense if I have a map view to channel the current position through a manager if I only want to display it. Yeah. So UI elements are allowed to directly access their access services. Now, the most important part of this architecture, or that I recommend to use if you want to go with this architecture, are commands. Commands are objects that wrap any function that you want to execute from the UI. It can be either a synchronous function or an asynchronous function, and they themselves are value notifiers. So the result of the function will be accessible over the value field of the command, and you can subscribe to a command to get updates. Now, it does not only have value notifiers. It's not only itself a value notifier, but it has also some very interesting properties that are also value notifiers, like is executing. Is executing is a bool value notifier that will change to true the moment you start the command and change back to false when it's finished. So ideal to connect to a progress indicator, for example. Then we have the thrown exceptions. If the wrap command that you have inside the wrapped function that you call inside the command throws an exception, your app doesn't crash, but the command is caught and then published on this thrown exceptions value notifier. So you can also subscribe to errors and react on your UI appropriately. Then we have a canExecute property, and canExecute tells you if this command can be executed at the moment. So you can use it to enable or disable a button, for example. Now you might wonder if is executing shows me when the command runs. Why do I have also a canExecute? Because this is exactly inverse to the is executing. So while the command is running, the canExecute will be false, and the command itself will block any further calls while the operation is running. The reason for this is we do not only have value notifier properties, but we can, when we create a command, also pass in a value notifier property, which is this here. Actually, I just saw that I have not updated this and this on this slide. It's now called restrictions and no longer can execute. So it has a restrictions input that so you can from the outside trigger if this command should be executed or not, which means if restrictions is switched to false, immediately can execute will switch to false independent of is executing. That's the reason why we have two of them here. Now, and another thing is that a command is a callable class, which means you can directly pass the command like a function. Like we see up here, if we have an onTextChanged event handler, we can directly pass in an onSearchChange command, for example. And it will be called with the value from TextChanged. This is, I know, it looks a little bit scary if you look at first on it, but once you have understood the concept, it's really nice to use. And to make this easier, I have a little animation to show you what's happening. So imagine the button here is pressed, and the event goes to the command. Now, is executing gives a green, can execute red, and the actual function is called. Now the value is coming back, and is executing goes false, can execute goes true again, which means the button is enabled again. I just run it once more. So you see, we can control a lot on the UI with just one command, where we otherwise possibly would need several separate value notifiers in our model. So this is all combined in the command class. Now, another building block, which I prefer, is the service locator getit. Because if we have this object here, we need somehow access the managers from the view, and we have to access the services from the managers, and maybe managers from managers. So we need a way to access them. So I personally prefer my service locator getit. You can also use any other locator like a provider or something else. Although the moment if you are below the UI, getit has the advantage that you don't need any context, any build context. And it's very easy to use, or very straightforward to use, I would say. you get an instance of Gedit. Gedit itself is an is a singleton. You in a setup function that you call before you start your app, you register your services or your model classes. Like here, I register an app model class, and I pass in a concrete implementation of this abstract class, which has the advantage that I can change the implementation on this side, and the app won't notice it, because inside the app we will only refer with the type that we use here when we register it. And so instead, the typical what we know, if we use an inherited widget, we access the app model like this, or as Gedit itself is a callable class, we can write it even shorter like this, and we have access to the update function inside, or the update command inside app model. Now, this is one way to use it, but I was asked if I could make it a little bit easier to use it, and therefore I wrote a mixin, the Gedit mixin, which allows to use it easier, because it allows you to listen to data changes inside objects that are stored inside Gedit. And we will see this in a moment in our code also. So it's a mixit on stateless or stateful widget. And in this example, we assume that our model class that it's stored in Gedit has a name property, and this name property is a value notifier. Yeah. And then I can use the watchX function, which is defined in the mixin, to access the value of this name property. And now the nice thing about this, this is every time this name property here will change, watchX will trigger a rebuild of this stateless widget. So we don't need any value notifier builder inside our code, in our tree, which makes the code much better readable. Yeah, we can just use it like this. And because WatchX uses this accessor function, we can access any property inside our model. There are different watch functions. I won't show you all here, depending on how your object is structured, but they always ensure that the stateless widget is rebuilt automatically. But we can do even a little bit more. For example, if we have in our model a stream or a future that we want to react on, we can use the watch stream or watch future function of the mixin. And it will automatically update the current user here each time this stream here changes. Which actually means, if you have ever if you have ever used streams or futures inside a widget, you typically need a stateful widget to do this. Especially if you want to react with some, if you not just build a widget based on the stream, but if you want to react on stream events, yeah. So with the mixin, you don't need this. We can just use a stateless widget. Yeah, it will always update as soon as the data changes. We can even register handlers that will be called. Like in this case, we want to have a dialog shown the moment that the name property changes, or also based on streams or on a future. And in this case, the mixin takes care about that everything is disposed at the end. You don't have to care about this, and you can do this inside a stateless widget. Let's see some code after we have this introduction. And I will first show you the app that we are using here. It's a pretty simple, it's a quite basic application. It's an app that queries an open weather API on the web, And you see, as soon as I trigger, the button gets disabled. And then I have up here a search box where I can type, and then it will filter. And if you look closely, it updates not with any key press, but it waits a little bit, a moment, some 500 milliseconds, which is a good idea to do if you hit a remote point, that you don't send requests on any enters, but you wait a moment when the user stops typing. And we will see how we can realize this by the use of the commands that we use. And then I have, just to show also this possibility, we have here a small switch. If I switch this, it will disable the update, and it's not no longer accessible. Also, if I...
Thomas, people in chat asking, could you please increase the font size a little bit?
Oh, yeah, sure.
Yeah. Yeah, just write in chat, is it enough or not? I think it's enough. Yeah. Thank you very much.
No problem. As also the search box is also it's also blocked if I use this use the switch. And now let's see how this is realized. Okay, let's start by the by our main Dart file. Very basic. The only thing is we have another function. I call it, in this case, register view model. Actually, it's not really a view model. It's more services and managers. And as shown before, we register a weather service with a weather service implementation. In this case, it's the same class. We don't have separate classes for the implementation, and also a weather manager. Now, have a look at the we start from the bottom, from the weather service. As you see here, I have organized this based by not by layer directly, but more like features. Like in this case, the homepage is the important point, and it has managers, and it has a model, and it has a service, and it has the actual page. Now, the weather service is rather basic. It's an async call, an update call into the Open Weather Map API, and does JSON deserialization. So nothing extraordinary here. It gets more interesting when we go to the manager. That's what you see here is all that we need to implement the functionality, the logic that we have seen in the UI a moment before. And that's possible because we use three commands here. We have on one side the update weather command, which actually will do the updating. And every command has an input and an output type. And actually, if you can also use a command without a return value. In this case, your output type would be void, but you still could listen for the end of your function call. Yeah, so this is still possible if you subscribe to the command. So we have the update weather command. We had a set execution state command. This will be used for the switch, and it has an input of bool and output of bool. And a text change command, which also has an input string and an output string. So now let's see how we create them. The set execution state command uses factory function create sync, and we pass in a synchronous function. And as the command is a value notifier, it needs an initial value, and we set it to true. In this case. Now, you might wonder, does this function only pass in gets in a bool value and directly passes it out again? The reason is that we don't use the command really to execute a function, but we use it to store the current state of the switch, because a value notifier has its own state. So every time we call set execution state command with a new state value, the value of the command will change, and we will see that the switch on the UI will listen to the to this command to display its change. Because if you have ever used a switch, you know a switch itself does not store its state. It needs on a rebuild its current state always passed in. Now, the update weather command, in this case, we have an create async command because we want to wrap an async function. And we directly can pass in the weather service, and we access it over GetIt. The capital I is a shortcut for instance. GetIt I, weather service, update. That's all we pass into the create async function. We pass in an initial value, an empty array, an array list. And you see here, as a restriction, because we want to be able to lock this command, we directly pass in the set execution state command. And by this, we already have realized or have wired up the behavior that the command will react on changing on of the switch. Now, the text change command will be the command that we use in the UI for the text field, for the search field. And also here, we use it just as a buffer of the value, and we will see why we do this, because we want to implement this possibility that it waits a moment before it sends something out. And I wrote another package, which is called functional listener, which you can use completely outside this context. It offers Rx-like data processing extension methods for value listenables. So for value notifiers, for example, or any other object that implements value listenable. And one of these commands is debounce. And debounce does exactly this. It returns itself a value notifier, but this value notifier will only update if the value of text change command stays stable for at least 500 milliseconds. And then the listen extension function just makes life easier when it comes to subscribing to a value notifier, because it directly passes in the current value in the function that you pass as parameter, and also passes you in as a second parameter, we don't use it here, a cancel function, so that the listener itself could cancel this listening, that it does not longer listens to it. And all it does inside here, we call the execute function of the update weather command. I could have omitted the execute because the command is a callable class, but inside the business logic, I prefer most of the time to use execute because it's more, I think it's more expressive in this case what it does. And for debug reasons, I listen here on the throw exceptions of the update weather command to print it out. And at the beginning of our app, we call the execute function once to trigger a rebuild of the app. So let's go one step higher. Let's go to our UI. So this UI, we use in this case the GetIt mixin to make our life a little bit easier, because otherwise it would look look a little bit more complicated. We can have a look how it looks without it. Without it, we would have in did change dependencies. We would subscribe to the thrown exceptions, and we would dispose this subscription in dispose, and we would use some value listenable builder here, and another value listenable builder here, And another value listenable builder here. But with the mixin, we can do it like this. We can use a stateless widget. We use the register handler function to subscribe to the thrown exceptions. And the only thing is we have to check the error parameter if it's not null, because as thrown exceptions is a value notifier, it always has a value. Yeah, that's the difference to the stream. If you use a stream, a stream can wait till the next item appears, but value notifier always has a value. So every time a command is executed, it will first update the value of thrown exceptions to null. Yeah, so you have to check this. That is that it's really the call here is because of an error and not because the reset of the error. So then we use watchX that I showed before, and we assign the result of watchX to three variables: is running, update button enabled. This is the value for the switch. No, it's the value if the if our button or the update button, if this one is enabled. Yeah, and we have the switch value, and all of them will automatically be updated if any of these values here changes. And so with this, our UI looks much easier. We have here in the on changed, we pass over the text change command. And in this case, we use the get command from the mixin, which is the same as if we would call get it with it, just a little, just a shorthand. And we have then here a stack variables view. And instead of the value listenable builder we saw before, we can directly use the conditional feature of Dart for lists. We can enter an if, check the value that we got from the update weather command is executing, and if true, we show an progress indicator on top. On the on our button, we use the update button enabled value that we got from WatchX to switch the on pressed handler between null and the real command. So it will be enabled and disabled, and the switch gets the value from switch value, and we pass as on change handler the set execution state command. And that's basically all is needed to implement this functionality. So if you look back to the manager once more, commands are typically set up in the constructor, a constructor of your manager. And the way you wire them up, it's a sort of declarative approach to define your logic. Yeah, it's not that you define what's going on, because you use this, the combining functions from functional listeners together with commands, and you can clearly describe by this way how should it behave. By the way, if you prefer, if you are a stream fan, there's another package which is called RX command. It's the predecessor of Flutter command, which does the same just with streams. So you can use RX Dart together with the commands. So yeah, another look at the project structure that I typically use in an RVMS app. This here is an example of my current app that I'm working on. It's structured by features. In this case, I have a main page. I have an very important part of the main page is a map. So this gets its own feature, and it has its own manager. And all widgets that are used by this feature exclusively are always always put inside the feature folder. Also here, the tracking processing has its own model manager. And it goes all day like this. There is a shared folder widgets, which is used where all widgets are placed in that are used by several features. And I have a shared folder, which is really used where also services can be in that are used from several features, or even a manager can be in there if it's used from several features. And it's way easier to navigate inside this structure than if you would have organized it by type. So if you just had one folder for all widgets, one folder for all for all managers, and one folder for all services. Another thing that I think it's important, and it's a sort of philosophy how I prefer to walk. I call it a self-responsible widget, which means every page or more complex widget knows how it gets the data it needs. So you don't push every data into the widget from outside, but the widget knows it itself. That's typically not really a problem, because most complex widgets and pages in an app won't reused ever again somewhere else. So it's completely okay that this widget knows what sort of managers or services are available and can get the value from there. So a widget itself does not implement any business logic. Yeah, this is important. It uses a manager below, and the part of the UI that it implements only is only for one part of your business logic. So you don't mix different topics in one responsible widget. Yeah, so that you don't couple them too much. Yeah, so that typically a widget will only communicate with one manager and not with several ones. There can be exceptions, sure, but in general, do it. And by doing this, such a complex widget is relatively easy to test, because you know exactly which objects from the layers below do you need. And for example, you can easily mock a manager by passing a mock implementation when you register the manager. And this idea also, I think it's important that if I work on an app, that I don't just get the information here, write, please write this widget. It will get passed in this and this function, this and this values, and it has to display it. But I prefer if I am responsible from the widget down to the needed service for one vertical slice of functionality. And because it's, at least for me, it's a way better motivation to work this way. So that's it. Here are some resources. You can find me as Thomas Burkhardt B on Twitter. If you have any questions, just connect with me or on Escomateur. Yeah. If you have any questions, I'm here.
Yeah, thank you very much, Thomas. And yeah, it was a nice talk about architecture. And if you are not using this approach so far, please try it. And we have several questions. And by the way, dear chat, dear attendees, viewers, community, ask your questions in the YouTube section, and we have plenty of time to answer them all. And yeah. The first question is, what is the biggest difference, and you already highlighted it, but still, what is the biggest difference between manager and service?
Okay, the service captures your business logic. What is, how is the data processed and changed? Yeah, and it will, it also is the interface where the UI gets typically its data back. The service lies below, and the service is a really dump object. It's just the interpreter between the outside world and your UI. So, for example, if you have an API endpoint that you want to query, like in this case our weather service, it will make the call. It will deserialize, but it won't do anything else. Yeah, so it won't. If you have a more complex app, it won't change anything. All CRUD operations, create, update, delete, will be on a manager level.
Mm-hmm. Okay, thank you. Next question is, so sometimes people arguing about Redux. It's a state manager, but like a Redux in sense of architecture, because of the it's the boilerplate is super huge. You have to have a lot of things to just to have it work. What about the boilerplate for RVMS? So is it like problem for a big project or not?
I mean, if you I just if you look if you yeah let's just I will just switch back to,
for instance, for commands. So maybe I don't know if I have plenty of commands.
Yeah, I have plenty of commands, because if people want to look at the code, it's from the, it's on their own. Yeah. Typically I wouldn't use that much commands in a real app, because it's quite speaking. And if you look here, honestly, I don't think I see any real boilerplate here, because, okay, we have to define them. We create them, but when we create them, we already pass logic to them. So it's really minimal boilerplate. That's for sure.
Okay, yeah, that's nice, because yeah, sometimes like for some architectures, for example, like Redux, it can be a problem with all this. Like,
yeah, that's the reason why I really hate Redux. It's I think Redux, it was one of the biggest mistakes, that Redux was one of the first patterns brought to Flutter, because it came from in the React world. I know it's very important, because they have other conditions, and so they because Flutter is named as influenced by React, people thought, okay, pass it over. But I think it's not the ideal pattern for a Flutter app.
Yeah, and somewhere like in the, I don't know where it is right now, where he is, Brian Egan, the author of the Redux for Flutter, is like, oh, okay, sorry. Okay, the next question is from Adrian. Some disadvantages of this architecture, maybe you can count some of them.
I would say it's very easy to overview what's going on in such an, in this sort of architecture. I think the command pattern, if you have once understood the principle, is also it's, one of the things. For example, here I can always navigate through this by use of go to definition, yeah, because I use the the command here appears on the UI level. If I go to definition, I will go back here into the code, and I can see, oh, what's this, what's going on there? Okay, let's hit here F12, and we go down to the service, for example. Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
So this is for me an important point of this, and also this ability that I learned to love with rxstart to describe your business logic in a more sort of declarative way, instead of that I have to go through some for loops and looking what's going on there. For example, this debounce here, if you implement it, it is 5 or 6 lines of code, and you have to, if you don't know what's going on, you're, oh, what will this do? Here I read, okay, it's the debounce, and then it's we listen on it, and we do something on the listen, yeah? So it's, in my opinion, after a short learning period, it's very easy to read.
Mm-hmm. Okay, nice. Next question is, actually, it's a bit controversial, and it's like, we can argue about it. Next question is, so this Gerrit mixing, and like actually, so it's based on the pattern service locator, right? And
What do you mean? What do you mean by Flutter service locator?
Not a Flutter. I mean pattern.
Oh yeah, yeah. It's yeah. Gerrit is a service locator, right?
Yeah. So and there are some like opinions that service locator is anti-pattern. And also, I can share my screen. I found this. Actually, I remember this book. I've read it. I don't remember. Dependency Injection by Steven Van Dursen and Mark Seaman. And they're saying that service locator actually is dangerous pattern and anti-pattern.
Yeah. Okay.
So, yeah. So what do you think about it?
I think it's bullshit. and honestly, there is a very good a post by Martin Fowler, who is a very well-known expert on architecture, where he compares dependency injection and service locator, and he definitely says it's not an anti-pattern. It's completely okay if you use it. In my opinion, actually. This discussion is a very academical one, and at the end of the day, it counts that we ship an app, and a service locator just does its job. And if you have seen, like I here in the code, I always see directly when I access Gerrit. I know where it's from. It's something that's in Gerrit. Yeah. If I have a bigger function. And I have an automatic dependency injection through a constructor, and I read the code and I'm like, oh, where is this coming from? How is this done? Yeah. And besides that, Dart is not really easy to implement and completely dynamic dependency injection. Yeah. So I personally would never say it's an anti-pattern, or at least I have not seen any argument that convinced me why it's bad. Just to make the point, all the other applications, packages that we have for this, like Provider or Riverport, they are all also only locators. Yeah, so it's not so special.
Yeah, and about the provider, Vadim is asking, what's the difference between your approach and the provider library? Because they both provide the same, like watch method, future stream providers, and so on.
Yep, that's true. The the mixin is I also write this in the README, is heavily influenced by the work of Remy, but it's not so much compared with the. The watch is partly is from provider, partly it's from Flutter hooks, because I don't need a special stream provider widget, but I can directly assign it to a variable with the watch stream statement. I think one of the advantages is that Gerrit does not need the build context. So you can use it always outside of the UI tree. It's an you don't clutter your UI tree with special widgets to inject your objects into the widget tree that you can access it from above. It's completely independent from this. And besides this, it has some very nice additional features, like, and it has a very comfortable management of startup initialization of asynchronous objects. So, because this is very closely related what we are doing there, and it supports also scoping in a different way than provider does it. But in the end, to be fair, it's a matter of taste. It's really very much a matter of taste. You have to see what fits better to your approach. What do you need? And for example, if you love provider or Riverport, but you think the command is really neat, then just combine them two together. Yeah, so this is completely open.
So it's not some kind of competition between you and Remy.
Oh, sure, we compete. But on the other side, we have both a lot of respect for each other. I love Remy. He's really a great guy.
Yeah,
Yeah.
yeah.
Sometimes I get a little bit annoyed because I see the 100th post on provider popping up on Medium, and I think, okay, perhaps somebody could also post something about Getit. But looking at the number of likes that Getit has, it's also it has a quite big fan community. So I'm happy with this.
Yeah. And by the way, for those who are watching this talk right now, so please, I don't know, show what do you think about the talk, about the architecture. I don't know, any emojis appreciated, emojis or opinions. Do you like it? I hope so. And the last question, we have time for the last question, but of course there are some other questions. So about self-responsible widget. And it may read data directly from managers, services, and isn't it a bit dangerous in sense of, for instance, the amount of links between objects? For example, you would like to refactor something, and there are like dozens of widgets, and it's hard to control these things.
That's why I said I talk in this case about more complex objects, yeah. So typically, if I have, for example, I have a page with a list view, yeah. It might be that I have the list view as a separate widget that is self-responsible, that it accesses the list, for example, but it but not the, the single list items wouldn't be self-responsible, yeah. So it's really it's really a way, a little way to balance on a on an on a level which is an as a widget with a certain complexity that, which makes sense to organize self as self-responsible, or which is really just an beautified container which probably does get passed in its way its values. Yeah, that's completely completely right, yeah.
Okay. And actually, yeah, there is another question. I will show it on the screen because it with the syntax. So beginner question, and Jan123 asks, beginner question, could you please explain this get weather manager? So syntax, is it anonymous function which expects a weather manager, or so in this context, what
Oh,
this?
okay. Yeah. The thing is, this is an get is an a generic function, which means it expects a type to pass in. And internally, it uses this type that you pass in this case, not as a parameter, but as a generic power, as you don't pass it as a normal function parameter, but it's as an generic parameter. Internally, it uses this type to look up the real weather manager object inside a map inside Getit, and returns you the weather manager. I hope that this.
I know it by the. So, for example, would you like to see the feature in Dart that if you are calling a function without any argument to get rid of the braces?
Actually, in many cases you can you can ignore them. For example, if I have if you have on the other side of the get statement, if you have there a weather manager m a weather manager vm equals get, you can do this because of the type inference. Get will know which object is required. And it will get it will return you the correct object. Sometimes it doesn't work, but in most of the times it will work. I personally, because I think it's more documentative, I always pass in the type, because then also I get more usable errors if there is some.
Okay, so looks like that's it for the questions because we need some short break and the time for announcements. Thank you very much, Thomas, and it was a pleasure to have you second year in a row, and I hope to see you next year.